What's going on, everybody? Tyr here tonight. I'll be leading the show. Brett is in another undisclosed location while I'm here on the broadcast. So sit back, relax, and we're going to talk about some plots tonight. So again, what's going on, everybody? Tyr. Like I said, Britt's gone for the night, but we do have some awesome things coming up tonight. The subject line is plots. And so most of you know who are fans of the show, I'm a writer, but we also have some awesome writers who have joined us tonight. So I'm going to start bringing them on and let them tell you a little bit about themselves, the companies that they run, the stories that they've written, the books they have coming up, and all of that good stuff. So first up, we're going to bring in Jay Sandelin. And I hope I pronounced it. What's going on, Jay? I hope I pronounced your last name right. Sandelin? That's it. Did I say it right? Your last name?
Sandelin.
Okay. Gotcha. So Jay Sandelin here.
Grumpy cat face.
Yeah, so sometimes I do mess up. Not as much as Brett, but I do mess up names sometimes. So
it's okay, TR. It's okay.
Nice. So tell us a little bit about what you do, Jay.
That's what I do. I'm Jay Sandelin. I write comics. I write books. I'm the author of Over the Ropes from Mad Cave Studios, as well as the Hellfighter Quinn from Mad Cave Studios. And we're going to release another one in the fall that's going to be really great. It's called World Class. It's going to be one of the launch titles for Mad Cave's young adult line, World Class. It's about a European soccer tournament with some crazy, hyperactive, hormonal teenagers from all over the world. So you have some Cobra Kai kicking a soccer ball.
Okay.
And I'm also in prose. I've written Space Police Files. You can get that on Amazon. I've written the number one Amazon bestseller, It Calls from the Sky, 24 Terrifying Tales from Above. I got to submit one of those, and some other great artists from around the world with Erie River Publishing. I have, and then I guess my big thing is coming up for this year, the soonest thing, I guess I should say, 3/31/21. You're going to get Zenoscope's quarterly Tales of Terror, H.H. Holmes, America's most notorious serial killer, comes back to roost. So
very awesome.
Very fun with that book. It's going to be a 72-page original graphic novel for only $8.99. You can read it in one sitting, and it has two different art teams.
Oh, wow.
It's a series where, I guess it's a book. It's a book where a good portion of the story takes place in the 1800s. Some takes place in the present. And we have an art team doing each timeline.
Oh, wow.
So, check it out in your local comic shop. Zenoscope is doing a lot more in the way of these one-shots and original graphic novels, putting them out often, making them affordable, and giving you a one-shot read. I'm going to have some more to talk about this year, but I guess that's about all I can talk about now. But find more about me on my website at jsandelin.com. Follow me on Twitter, Instagram, and Facebook, jsandelin_, and sign up for my newsletter. I have cookies.
Hey, he has cookies.
Online cookies. I know some people out there who love cookies. So if you love cookies, I mean, yeah, I'm for you.
There you go. Next up, we have another awesome writer. Tony, and I'm going to let him tell you. I'm pretty sure you all may know him, too. So I'm going to let him go ahead and tell you about himself. So here's Tony. What's going on, Tony? How you doing? Pretty good, good. Ah, no problem.
Jay, thanks how you doing? Here. I like cookies, Jay. I like cookies.
Hey, all right, Cookie Monster. All right. we're gonna team up for the gritty reboot of Cookie Monster. You know, taking back the streets.
That sounds perfect.
Taking
that
back
sounds perfect. Indeed.
So Jay, go ahead and tell us a little bit about who you are and what it is that you're doing and what we can expect from you this year as far as stories and comics and things of the sort.
Well, I am the head writer over at Advent Comics, and we produce all manner and all genre of comic books, everything from science fiction to action to horror to, of course, bread and butter superheroes. Coming this year, you guys are going to get more of the Regulators, Titan the Ultraman, our big 12-issue maxi series we have going on called Cosmos, which doubles as a 85 company and creator crossover book. You're going to see more of that coming up this year. Okay. We also have a book that I love. It's a crime noir, gritty thriller type of revenge kind of book called Southside. That drops on Kickstarter actually week after next, February 3rd.
Okay.
And it's a mature readers only title. No children under the age of under 15 for this book. Please, I can't express it enough.
Definitely got to let that be known.
Situations, language, nudity, graphic violence, and I just don't want the kids exposed to that. So this is definitely a mature reader's title.
I hear you there. We got some folks. Let me see. In case comics say he likes chocolate chip cookies. So there we go.
Jay started some of the cookie thing. He started some with the cookie.
Yo. Jay, you got a fan out here.
That's not a fan. That is a peer. that's my friend and brother Brian Hawkins.
Brian. No.
We know Brian.
Hey B, B, congratulations on the success, brother. Brian Hawkins is a dope writer. He did some stuff in our 10th anniversary book, and he also has some amazing stuff coming out this year. Follow Brian Hawkins.
Yes. If you haven't already, his series with Black Box Comics, Devil's Dominion.
Yes, I've seen that.
It's just kicking off. And I was lucky enough to put a review of the first issue up and talk to him on my podcast. I don't know if you've seen the previews world, but Mr. Brian wrote the sequel to Zenoscope's Gretel. And wow. Yeah. That's going to be presented in the same format as my H.H. Holmes book, the 72-page original graphic novel. His is coming in the middle of February. So definitely look for that one.
And that cover, he released that cover over on Facebook, and it looks amazing. So I can only imagine the story behind it.
It does look like a good cover, I may know a bit about the story behind it, and that there's going to be
inside scoop.
We got it's going to get it's going to get dark. You may want to hide your children for that one too. I don't know. But.
There you go, Jay. Brian said he's a fan. He said I'm a fan too.
I'm a fan of Brian's. I just bought some of old Brian's merchandise for his upcoming. You know, he's got a book with Scout coming up, Scout Comics, who deal, you know, you guys kind of, you're in the business of starting your own imprints. Mm-hmm. I've not done that. I've not started a pub because I'd like to keep my hair. Sorry, Tony. And,
trust. Heavy as the head, the weird clown. The hairline shows.
Is either you lose it or it turns gray.
I'm telling you.
Scout allows for creator-owned titles. His creator-owned title, Black Cotton, is kind of like a reverse world with African Americans on top, white people on the bottom, and it's a lot of great world building. I go on if you go on Scout's website. I just bought a face mask this week for Black Cotton.
Okay.
Ironically,
I'm tempted. I'm sorry. I'm tempted to go on Scout's page because I like their box sets that they're doing, the monthly subscription boxes. So I definitely want to check out one of those and see how it compares.
Check it out. Check out, you know, Brian's series. I'm kind of wondering, though, Brian, is the black cotton mask made of polyester? Because I think that's just kind of a false advertisement. But, yeah, wear a mask. If you're not at this point, you're an asshole. So wear a fucking mask.
Wear a mask.
Agreed.
Speaking on that and hearing the synopsis of that storyline, I'm going to go into a question. I don't know if this has been asked of you or probably because I know it's been asked of me, but out of all the stories that you wrote, that you've written, which plot will you feel was the hardest one for you to actually bring into fruition? Because I know I've had hard plots where some of them I just look at it and I'm like, okay, I got to step away from this because it's wanting to go different ways and I needed to streamline. Or one of my most recent stories, it gets pretty dark, so I had to go into a dark place to write it and then come out of it. So what would you say is like some of the hardest plot lines to lead to some of your stories that you've had to put together?
Jay, you want
anyone can go first. Whoever has the answer, anyone can go first.
For me, it's the Cosmos story, because that was a story that I had already written and had a middle, ending, beginning already set up. But when I had the idea to start my own comic company, I wanted to do something a little different with it because I had tired of the same old grand big storyline thing. And I want to do something along the vein of a War of the Independence type thing. So merging different characters and trying to get their stories and their histories lined up with the particular book and trying to plot all these different companies and creators and keep them all sorted and in my mind straight. That is a headache. That is a headache. I'm not going to lie, that's a headache. But
yeah,
I love it because it gets to spotlight a lot of different creators and publishers who I think do awesome and dope work. So to me, I love it. I love it. But it's hard. It's hard trying to get everybody a good part of the story, get their characters to shine a little bit, but still advance the story. So,
okay. Hold on real quick, Jay, before you answer. Demetrios is just got here. So I'm gonna go ahead and bring him in and let him introduce himself to everyone.
Hey guys, Demetrios, how are you?
How you doing? Welcome.
Pretty good, you? Thanks for having me.
No problem.
I had a little trouble getting on.
Yeah. Did you see the message I sent? Did that help?
I did, but I actually ended up using a different way to get in. I went directly through Chrome to use it. So
okay.
So it worked.
Gotcha. Was that message full of expletives and like, where the hell are you, D?
I don't blame you. I was saying my own expletives here, so.
All right.
So what I miss?
Just introductions. We got into the first question, but I'm gonna let you go ahead and introduce yourself to the viewers and everything, and let them know what it is that you have coming up, the books that you've written in the past, and all that good stuff. You know, this is your pedestal. So
Demetrios Zaharakis. I'm the CEO owner of Black Box Comics. Mm-hmm. So we're an indie based out of New York. And our first title, that was our launch title, was called IT, and it was basically about a IT guy who was like a detective within the banking system. And that was done by like several pros like Scott McDaniel, Andy Owens, who are from DC Comics, Taylor Esposito, Tio Gonzalez, who did color work for Aspen. After that, we had a bunch of other guys that were pretty well known, like Chuck Dixon did Militia for us.
Mm-hmm.
Kevin Graveau, who's the creator of Underworld and I, Frankenstein, wrote Cycle List.
Okay.
And then we had some indie guys like Ramel Hill, who did Bigs and Tiny, and I actually wrote the first issue with him. So that was my first writing credit, official writing credit. So I do try to get more time lately to try to see if I can write, but running the company and getting everything done at the same time is tough when it comes to like deadlines and everything. So it's been difficult.
Oh yeah, I get that.
But we're getting books out though. We're getting new titles out.
I get that. I understand that fully. Because I write everything and run everything. I don't draw everything. I have artists, so that's the one thing that helps me. Because
that's tough.
If I had to draw everything too, I would be pulling my hair out. So,
but it's rough enough not even being able to draw, just to organize the entire teams and do a little bit of editing on top of the editors. That's a lot of work. So
agreed. Trust. Yeah. Agreed. Agreed. So the first question that we got to, is all right, I call you D.
Yeah, that's fine.
So the first question we got to is like, what is the hardest plot you think you've had to write so far? And I think Jay had an answer. I saw his eyes glowing. He was ready to go. So Jay,
you know, well, I was moonlighting, writing some scripts. You know, I was young and I needed the money. And the hardest part of that plotting was motivation. What motivates your characters? Why do they do what they do? In this particular plot, my main character was a pizza guy who basically lives on his tips. And if he doesn't come back with the money, it's coming out of his check, you know, working class man. He's motivated by feeding his family, and he's only going to feed his family if he pounds that pavement. But then when he meets this amazing woman and she opens the door and says, "Is there another way I could pay for this pizza?" I had to find the motivation. Why would he give her free pizza? Why would a man ever do that to a woman standing at the door wearing nylons and heels and a lace-up teddy? And guys, you know, all I can say is I was young and I needed the money. So,
oh man, for folks that are listening right now,
I've seen that movie.
Oh, you've seen it. You're a fan. Thank you. I mean, it's completely, completely, so yeah.
For folks that are watching right now, if you have any questions for plots and plot lines, this is the perfect opportunity to ask. Your questions, and your questions will be shown, you know. So this is the perfect opportunity to ask your questions. D,
all right. did you have an answer? Serious answer. Okay. All right. My first comic series, which I had the amazing opportunity to write through Mad Cave Studios, Talent Search, Over the Ropes. It's a 90s pro wrestling comic. And it's 5 issues, 20 pages a piece, 100 page total. And when you're on a budget, you guys know you got to hit that page count sometimes. So in the pages that I had, it was all about finding the right beats. Now, whether some people write by the seat of their pants, I'm a plotter. I like to find the beats in the story. And with that particular story, it was about balancing action with emotion, with character development. Almost like the ingredients in the recipe. You don't want to go too heavy on the spices, but you don't want your final product to be bland either. And one of the hardest parts about plotting it out was deciding, you know, this is a wrestling story, was deciding at what point in which issues characters would win or lose the world title. So, you know, you got like your Kane and your Ric Flair in there coming at each other. And I'd have to decide, in this issue, is it too early to win the title? Is it too late? Or do they confess their secret love for each other first? Or do I keep that hidden for later?
Woo! He bore props. Yeah, exactly. I didn't get a chance to bring out my action figures.
What about you, D? That's leading to another question I'm going to ask later. But what about you, D?
I mean, some of the toughest ones I think were the most recent ones that I've done, which was Devil's Dominion and Gin Hunter, which I'm actually working on with Jay.
Can we just say the name?
Yeah, we said it. We let it go. We let it out.
Whoa.
We let it out.
I have not spoken this name yet, you know.
That's okay. Because we're getting there. So,
it's coming close.
Yeah, and you know, we start off with an initial concept, and I try to give like several options to the writers, typically. So for Devil's Dominion, as we talked about it and went through it, you know, me and Brian had phone calls and messaging and just continuously trying to make progress on that concept and develop it and the character, where we wanted that character to go, the location. You know, how you could use that location to your advantage possibly, and what the goals are. So, you know, one thing with Devil's Dominion, if you read it, it's actually going to be out. It was a little late, but it's going to be out, I believe, in about a week or two. Okay. It's the view that you're looking at the story from. And our main character, Devlin, views things in a certain way where you see people with demons and other people that don't have demons and how they view her. And it's interesting the way that it changes. It's not like she turns into the Hulk. She doesn't just form and turn into something that everybody sees. It's only something that someone could see within you. So I thought that was a challenge for the artist, because he obviously can't make a mistake when that's supposed to apply or not as well. So we had to be very clear in our outline, in our script. So I thought that was a little challenging. And then with Jin Hunter, me and Jay were going back and forth at it for a while, trying to nail that down. And thankfully, between Jay and Brian are both great writers, so they were able to be tremendous help to me to help get that done. So, you know, when we did Jin Hunter, basically about there's a genie that gives bad wishes and everything goes wrong. And we have the main character who tries to correct everything. I don't want to give away too much, but that's the gist of it. And you know, we played around with where that was going to be, whether it was going to be the hero carrying that element with the bad wishes, the villain. And, you know, Jay did a phenomenal job writing that. So I really can't wait for everybody to read that book.
Sounds interesting.
Very interesting.
Yeah, I picked that. Yeah, I kind of like that, because I'm hearing about it. I actually have a Jin Hunters in my comic book universe.
Well, we won't give away too much, but I will say that for a big part of that plot is that for every wish, there is a price.
Oh, yeah.
Right.
Because that's actually the... Yeah, that's actually the true lore with the Jin, because when I was creating, like, I have a lot of stuff in the Sovereign Comics universe, but I have Jin Hunters are one of them. But I was actually doing research. I don't know if y'all have heard of this book, and this goes to one question I have. This book called The Vengeful Jin, which is a book that I bought to do research on to understand the Jin lore and how things like that work and how I can apply it to my characters and all of this good stuff. These characters that or their family bloodline actually hunts Jin because Jin hunt them. So it's kind of like a blood feud going back and forth. So I did a lot of research in that, trying to figure out what was going on. So that leads to this question, like, how much research do you do? Because I know, like, when I've been asked, and I tell people, like, I research a lot. Like, if I don't know this particular science, I'm going to go pick up a Michio Kaku book or a Neil deGrasse Tyson book or something to try to figure out that type of science so that it works. So I know Jay was saying earlier about, you know, flying off the seat of your pants with your plot, or, you know, keeping it, you know, or plotting things out. So how often do you research? Like, do you research a lot when you get to certain things? Do you research, for instance, let's say, dealing with demons, like in the story you were talking about, the recent story you have, like, do you look into demonology or religious stuff to make sure that you kind of, you know, get things a little bit, or do you just keep it fantastical, you know?
Yeah, no, there is a decent amount of research, and the advantage I have on the demon book, which is Devil's Dominion, is that Brian, I think he was taking courses or classes on theology and things like that, so that came to our advantage. On top of the research that we were doing. You'll see there's certain characters that are in there that play into some of the biblical stuff and whatever, but we don't really go heavy religious within the book. We keep it more on the human condition of everyone has a demon.
Yeah.
Right. So, in the sense of Jin Hunter, we did do a lot of research. We even did research on the type of name we should give the character so we could represent the right group and give people the proper name. And where do Jins come from and how they were made and where the folklore is and everything. So a lot was going back and forth between me and Jay. I was sending him links. He was sending me stuff. And you know, we try to make the best of what we had. And I think it came out really great. It's just and each book that we have at the company is very unique in terms of art, story, So I think each one is going to stand out on its own, which is good.
Very awesome. Very awesome. Anybody else want to try at that one?
Well, I don't have a Jin Hunter in my book, but I do have a character that's called Jin over my regular's title. Mm-hmm. And we don't get too far into its origins, mm-hmm. but we did a lot of research on Jins and things of the mythology and actually the religion part behind Jins. Mm-hmm. And he appears in the book that just released. Well, it hasn't released yet. It was a Kickstarter, but it's going to be releasing probably about another 2 weeks. You'll see that character, Jin. He'll take a little bit of front stage. But we do. And in our spirit line, we do go deep into religion. Actually, not only just the characters, we deal with religion as a story, a plot in a story. We also do religious mythologies and tenets and things of that nature. So we do go a little deep in our savior title, in our title called The Real Guard.
Okay, that makes sense. What about you, Jay?
Well, we talked about Jin Hunter. With H.H. Holmes, the research into the plot was history, mm-hmm. which I do have my master's in. So, I mean, I guess you could say I researched extensively beforehand.
Oh, yeah.
But I think for me, it's important to be familiar. I probably watched, there's a great H.H. Holmes documentary on Amazon, and I watched that. I learned about this serial killer and how he killed. And I really think that made the script possible. Mm-hmm. Because we had to not, when it comes to your plot, you can choose to feed your reader like they're drinking from a fire hose, mm-hmm. or you can leave some breadcrumbs along the way and lead them to that great house of candy. I know which one they'd probably prefer, because if you start drinking from a fire hose, you're probably not going to stick with it for very long.
Oh, yeah.
But if you're following that trail of breadcrumbs, you want to see where it ends up.
That's a great analogy, though.
I do have to say, as a career firefighter for over a quarter of a century, you don't drink from fire hoses. It's bloody painful. You never drink from fire hoses.
And especially with comics, you don't tell everything to your readers. Mm-hmm. And that goes for prose as well, but it especially goes for graphic arts.
Yeah.
The story moves through the pages and the images. I was actually just talking to somebody, another wrestling fan, about, I don't know if anybody remembers the Ultimate Warrior comic.
Oh, that's my favorite wrestler.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah.
Jim Helwig decided in 1990, the late 90s, that he was going to create a brand of Ultimate Warrior comic books.
Mm-hmm. Yep. Called Warrior. Yeah.
Well, they were, they received mixed results. I think he tried to rape Santa Claus in one of them. But there's one issue, there's one page that kind of tells you what you need to know about it. He had an entire splash where his character is like, and I'm sorry, I have to use Kane because I don't have the warrior handy. But his character's down here, and then everything over here is the word bubble. And it's just a wall of words, 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 words. And, you know, no one's going to stop to read a wall of words in a comic book. Mm-mm. So how do you keep your lines short, crisp, to the point, move it along? I've used what some have called the Morrison method, trying to keep maybe 25 or less words per bubble, mm-hmm. 35 or less per total panel, and usually not more than 2 to 3 lines per panel if I can avoid it. Otherwise, your letterer may put a bounty on you.
Yeah,
because I hate you.
Yeah, I letter too, and I hate when that stuff happens. Like, even for myself, like I've cursed at myself. Like, I'm like, what were you thinking? chop it down. I just start taking words out, you know, like, nope, this ain't gonna work. You know, say more with less. Here's a question. Let me see. Do your stories drive the plot or do your characters drive the question? That's coming from Sina. I hope I pronounced your name right. But that's a good question because I know for me, it's kind of both. Like I've been in situations where I start doing something with the character. And since a lot of the characters are characters that I created, so they're in, you know, in here, I'll get like that voice to be like, I wouldn't do that. I wouldn't do that. Change that. You know, and I know I've mentioned that to people before and they're like, are you crazy? I'm like, no, that's just what happens. I mean, I think I talk to other writers and they're like, nope, you're not alone. It happens to us too. But what about y'all? Does the story drive the plot or do sometimes the character comes in and takes over and drives the plot for a little bit? Anyone can answer. Anyone can start.
Like you said, a little bit of both. In the book I have coming up next month called Southside, the story is that the main character comes home to find the murderer of his best friend. But after I started to develop the character, Dalton Malone, and his personality came out, I started liking the different aspects that he brought to the story. So I'm playing with letting the character drive a lot of the narrative in a lot of situations. But it's a 5-issue series. Issue 2 is done now. We're going to do issue 3 starting next month. And we have a special standalone issue, kind of since the character's getting popular now. It's like an origin story of him in another book we have called Black Starline. So okay. You heard it here first. You're going to see Dalton Malone's origin. Black Star Line number 5 coming out probably June-ish, July-ish.
Okay. Yeah, you got. I know you have a library of titles. And I know both. And I know both. Both of you do with, you know, with Black Box and Xenoscope and everything. You know, and you work for Black Box too. I'm trying to get to that level. I'm working to get to that level. So
yeah. I supported your last Kickstarter. Not only was it original, it was probably some of the best art I've seen on an indie title.
Thank you.
I'm looking forward to seeing where you go with this title.
Thank you. I appreciate that. Thank you. Thank you greatly. So who else wants to jump on that question?
I'm picking up your stuff with Jay and Brian, because these two guys are two tremendous writers, like you said, and I follow them as well. So you can expect to see me following your stuff from here on out.
I appreciate it. I take that back.
I followed IT back. You did a Kickstarter. You did like a crowdfunding for that back in the day, for issues 1 and 2, correct?
Not for IT. I did it for Biggs and Tiny was our first one.
Okay. Biggs and Tiny. I'm a backer of that one as well. Romero was good too.
IT came out in 2017 and that went through retail.
Okay. All right.
Okay. Jay, you want to say something, Jay?
I don't know. It was probably very profound, but I have no idea what it was. Sorry.
That happens to me all the time. Like I get an idea, it's like gone. So anybody else want to jump on that question? Or
what was the question?
Good, Jay.
Do your stories drive the plot or do your characters drive the plot? Or does it start off with a story?
If the time period lends itself to the narrative, I like to have my characters drive Honda Civics.
Okay. Only Civics?
With H.H. Holmes, we have a lot of horse and buggies. So.
Oh, man.
I mean, for me, it would be both. I mean, it depends on the rhythm that you get into and when you start out. Sometimes you might just take 2 steps back and then, you know, circle back a different way to go about it. So I don't think that there should ever be just one way of doing something. I mean, you do what works for you. And for each title may cause you to think differently. So
Agreed. It does. It helps out. Yeah, it does. I'll just leave that at that. Yeah, you're absolutely right. Let's see. When constructing the plot of your comic, do you plot it to the end after X issues, or do you just let it flow? That was a question I did have. Thank you in case for asking that. Like, how do you all plot your comics? Because I know in most, you know, the majority of comics, unless it's said to be a standalone, you know, there's a story arc, you know, there's an overarching story. So you have, you know, either a 4-issue story arc, 6-issue story arc, you know, or more. Do you plot from the beginning of that story arc to the end, or do you plot it issue by issue?
I mean, for me, I do beginning to end. Mm-hmm. Typically, I mean, there has been issue to issue, but typically I will try to do beginning to end and see where we could fill in the holes and just include things that are required. A lot of people focus on things like action sequences and things like mm-hmm. that. But I think there's a lot of the in-between, the journey of getting to that point of the buildup that you got to prep properly and make sure that those moments are memorable, no matter how small they may be. And mm-hmm. I think that will help everything, you know, be fully complete, well-rounded.
Okay.
For title, Titan the Ultraman, I have it plotted out all the way up until issue 12. We're on nice. 3 now. But some of the things that I want to do will probably push a lot of that plotting back. But as you write each issue, there are things you want to add, things you want to extend the story with, or things that you want to throw in subplots or what have you, that may extend that beyond what you've already plotted out. So I tend to try to start to plot to a point, the first story arc being issue 12, completing story arc issue 12. It may extend beyond that because there's some things that, as I play with the first two issues, I want to add. So we'll see. But I try to do, for that particular title, I do plot a range. Now, mm-hmm. some stories, it'll be issue by issue.
Okay. And I like for myself, I would say the book that I use to kind of create my universe, it's plotted out or short story written all the way up to, I think, 40 stories. So, wow. so that one's plotted all the way out.
Wow.
The thing is, like I've told people before, I can't release that one because if I release that one, then it's going to kind of spoil the overarching story that's going on between the titles now. So there is that one. Cypher Team, I think, is plotted out 6-7 issues, and I'm on issue 3 right now. Stars is plotted out. The first story arc, full first story arc is plotted out, so I know what's going to happen. And like for me, I do the same thing. Like I plot out the story. Now, do things change per issue? Yes, because in Cypher Teams, a lot of stuff changed. Even though I had to plot it, things changed, you know. But that plot, I use that as the guide to make sure, okay, try to stay along this path, but certain things changed. Like, for instance, some beginnings of the third part, what would have been the third issue, came into the second issue of Cypher Team. So I guess that will lead to another question too. Like, how often do, even though you do plot your stories, how often does it change? And what would you say to people as far as letting the story change if it's good for the story? Like, would you tell them, hey, just stick to your plot? Or would you say, hey, you plotted it. If something organic happens, let it happen. So Jay, if you want to.
Well, it depends on, all right. So it depends on the job. If you mm-hmm. are a work for hire, I've been work for hire on comics. And when you're work for hire, you don't as much fly off the cuff. You know, you're there to kind of play the music and you follow right. the sheets. Mm-hmm. But if you're looking and you kind of have to do that because with comics, you're always working on a team. Well, if I want to go and change something, that's all well and good, but there's an artist, a colorist, a letterist. They've got to meet schedules. They've got to get paid. Mm-hmm. Now, if you want to change things as you go, you can always work that out with the editor during the proper stages. And usually there's going to be a lot of creative freedom, you know, like I had with D and working on Gen Hunter. Mm-hmm. But then if you want total creative freedom, you go creator-owned, a lot like, you know, Tony has done and others have done with their own titles. And you can change things as you go. But it's like at the end of the day, you're paying for it. Did you just did you plan your third act finale again? Okay, that's great. But did your artist already ink those pages? Well, motherfucker, you're not gonna need Kickstarter. You're gonna need to go on Punch Farter and beg and say, "I changed the story. Would you give me more money?" That's that's trademark punchfarter.com, the crowdfunding site for indecisive writers. Punch Farter.
So you heard it here first. If you plan on writing for someone, stick to the plan.
And if you and then there's pros. I also write pros. I wrote for like I said, the Amazon number one bestseller for horror story collections, It Calls from the Sky. It's just words. So if you want to add pages, if you want to delete pages, if you need to change key elements, it ain't nothing but a backspace and some retyping. Just make sure you've got, if you're going to self-publish those things, you invest in a good editor to make sure the final product looks professional, is correct and free from errors, because, you know, I'm bad with patience. I always wanted to get things out there, but I have to remember, once it's out there, it's out there forever. Which is something that they told my parents after I was born, with a frown and an understanding stare. You know, he's out there now. You know,
he's here.
You unleashed this. I'm sorry.
Oh man. Anyone else want to dive on that?
Tony, you want to go?
Yeah, Tony, you want to dive on that? You got anything to add?
Only that I did a story for a friend, and I normally don't. Well, I've done it three times where I'll ghost pen a story, and it was a 16-page story. He told me characters he wanted to use. He told me what he wanted the story to be about and how to end it. If I were to do that story as creator, I probably would have changed it, because when I read some of the beats of his characters and things of that nature, I saw a couple of interesting ways to go about it. But he told me, hey, it has to end at this point. This character has to do this. So I'm like, okay, cool. But it just depends. Like Jay said, if you're working with someone else, they dictate how it goes. I may have done that story just a little bit differently, but I mean, he wanted the story this way for his book, and that's how I took it.
I agree. Yeah. I understand that. D?
Like I said before, there's no one way, I think. So I think you do change things. And in the case of Gin Hunter, we went back and forth several times and changed how we wanted to go about it.
I blocked most of that out now. I got blocked.
And then, we had things like IT and Project Icarus, which once that was set up and outlined and everything, that really didn't change much. That was a pretty easy flow, because we knew what we wanted. Everything was settled and discussed in detail. And Gin Hunter, we just had, I think, more flexibility to change it up. And we went with what we thought was best.
Okay. Ooh, here's a good one from Cena again. Let's talk arcs for plotting. Do you find each issue has its own arc while the issue series has the overall arc? Tony, you want to start with that one?
Yeah, it could. Let's say, for instance, like the first arc of the Titan Ultraman story was Titan accepting his power. So around about issue 4, that's when he starts to get comfortable with his powers or what have you. But certain things within that issue 2, at the end of issue 2 and issue 3 that I've done, have made me want to extend it a little bit, like I said earlier. So I'm going to add some other things that kind of popped up once I started writing characters. Like, oh, this could be interesting, and this would move the story in a different way if I do this or do that. So I think they can. I think both can actually happen.
Okay.
I agree with Tony. I mean, You could definitely do it that way. Typically, we like to have the issue by issue arc, or it may be like a 2-issue arc with an overall arc. So we've changed that up in different titles. We've done it differently. And again, when you work with different writers, you just get a different skill set, different way they go about things. So even from my end of it, I get to learn because each writer is completely different, and they bring something unique to the table.
Yeah. We all have our vices and our quirks and our ways of doing things. Like, gotta have music. Like, for me, when I'm writing, I gotta have music. Music has to be blasting in my ears. So, what about you, Jay?
I would I'll see your issue must have its own arc. What is this person's name? Kana Ale Ekander. Well, Kana. Arcs for plotting. Not only does each issue have an arc, it is each page has an arc. What am I trying to do with this page? Basically, am I trying to get from point A to point B? And how do I make the person want to turn to the next page? And then at the end of the issue, I have to, again, pick my beat, which I did during the plotting, hopefully, to decide how do I end on a note that would make the person want to pick up the next issue, or in the case of a prose book, go on to the next chapter, or in the case of a single graphic novel, then you've got story beats as well. In World Class coming up, we chose chapters, and instead of, because it's all in one thing, but H.H. Holmes is going to be one uninterrupted block with flashbacks to different time periods. So that's where your artwork sometimes shows the beats. It's the whole team finding the spots and the arcs. I guess she's telling you to behave, Tiger.
I think that was for you. Because this was the next part. Because this was the next part. Jay, I think you're in trouble.
I don't know what that crayon person wants, but they need to stay away from trouble. They need to stay away from my crap. I don't know what they're doing.
Oh man. Here's a question though, I think a lot of people who are wanting to get into writing like to ask writers. I know Dan writes. Dan, you write, don't you? If you're still here, answer that. I think you write and draw. So your favorite go-to plot devices, quests, cliffhangers, and red herrings. I like cliffhangers at the end of issues. I try not to do it too much, but I do like to add it because I want the person to want to know what's going on next. So I know a lot of people like I've read some comics where people will literally put the climax in the middle of the book and then the rest of the book is going down. And I'm like, for me, I'm like, especially when I'm doing story arcs where it's across titles, you know, I'm raising it up. But in the same, to answer to the last question, each one of my issues is its own, you know, arc. So you're going to have your climax in that issue, then climax in the next issue, so on and so forth to keep the person interested. So what about y'all? Like, what are your favorite plot devices? Like, for me, I like cliffhangers. There's a lot of people getting mad at me, but go ahead.
Yeah, same here. I'm a cliffhanger fan, so we typically go with that. You'll see issue by issue. Mm-hmm. We try to leave them wanting more. You'll see at like Devil's Dominion. I think with Brian, we worked on every single one that there was something to come back for, something to look forward to. We did something similar with Gin Hunter, Project Icarus. Where there's another character being introduced, up the ante every time. So I think a cliffhanger is the way to go.
I'm sorry, Dan. See, Dan's a badass. He writes and draws. I'm sorry. What about you, Tony? What is your favorite? What is your favorite?
A little bit of all three. As far as quest, over in the Regulators book, the heroes go on a quest, basically to save the Earth's culture supreme. So that issue ended on a quest where the heroes got together. They realized what their task was, so they go about that mission. Another quest per se could be the Southside book that's coming out, where Dalton is looking for the killer of his friend. Even in the first issue, he finds out who the killer is. So then he ratchets up the ante a little bit. He's going to go search for this guy. So it's a little bit of both. I have some books where there are some red herrings. Cosmos, mm-hmm. pretty much the first five issues, red herrings. But with issue six, everything starts to gel and it comes together into one cohesive storyline. Then it's like, oh, wow, didn't see that coming. Yeah. So a little bit of everything, Try to throw it all in there.
Okay. Well, man, Jay, what about you?
What are we talking about again?
Favorite go-to plot devices. Quests, cliffhanger, red herrings, or another.
I don't know what you would call it. Maybe like the reveal. My writing style is very much of revealing what's hidden. What's the hidden world? What is really going on just beneath the surface? I don't know if that's exactly if that's what you would call a plot device, or maybe that's just story structure. But I do like to have the reveal, and you know, just remind the reader that they never knew where I was going, and I'm a whole lot smarter than they are. Because that's why we write, isn't it? Just to tell everyone how much smarter we are than they are.
I won't say that, but I definitely want to try to fool you.
You don't say it out loud, right?
Of course not. Never say it out loud. Never say it out loud. Like what Aaron does to me, Aaron always tells me to map my stuff because I'm always talking to him about things. So he tells me out loud. He's a writer too. Tells me out loud. Got to do better. Oh man. So one question that I think also is important is for folks to understand the difference between plotting and writing. Would you say there's a huge difference between it, or would you say I know it has its similarities because when you're plotting, you're still writing, you know, but how do you feel about the difference between plotting the script and then writing the script? Because I know, like, for me, a lot of my stuff, because I started off before I went to comic book writing, which I learned later on, short stories, novel writing is totally different from comics. Like you can't. And I know, Jay, you probably, of course, since you've written prose and everything, you know this for sure. Like, it's a totally different beast. So I couldn't bring short story and novel writing over to comics because, you know, no one's going to pay for, you know, a 70 page floppy. So that's not going to work. But for you, how different do you think the two are? And do you think that a plot is needed for the story to start writing the story?
Okay. Your first question, how different are they? Mm-hmm. One of them is masturbation and one of them is an orgy. Because when you sit down to write prose, it's you and the Word document. And I don't want to make the gestures, but you're tugging out to reach the climax, and you're going through the highs and the lows, the crying, the self-loathing, the how did I end up like this? And then eventually you just you burst out with something satisfying, hopefully. So it's more of a solitary process compared to comic writing, mm-hmm. which you have a room full of people, you know, doing a job. They all have a part to play. It's a conveyor belt, and you have to play your role on the team. So if you don't want to work with others, if you don't want to stop, collaborate, and listen, then go write prose, because comics is all about collaboration. Mm-hmm. And that goes with the plot as well. When writing a comic script and writing a prose, you also have to remember that the comic script comes a little more naturally for me, because there's a whole lot less pressure, because the only person that's going to see this script are the other people in the comic book team. Mm-hmm. So if I screw up with a dangling participle on the wrong adjective, because Webster's 1962 English law says Yeah. Right. Fuck grammar. I don't worry about it. I just make sure that my comic script is legible, to the point, and gets the message to the editor, the artist, maybe the colorist, and doesn't make the letterist want to shoot me in the head. Mm-hmm. There's a lot more pressure when it comes to prose, and that's why you do need, once you have drafted, once you have finished your portion, then you do want to let other people in on it and make sure that you've got a finished product that's ready for, you know, the spinner racks, mm-hmm. your paperback novel with, you know, that eventually ends up on the 99-cent bin at Great Value brand.
Okay. Jay, I had a question for you. Prose as opposed to comic writing, how long does it take you to, let's say, do comic scripts as opposed to doing a single prose chapter, maybe?
It takes me, like I said, writing a comic script comes a bit more naturally, and I'm not going to have to go back. It's not that one necessarily takes longer than the other, but the prose takes longer because you're going to have to keep going back over it again. And a comic script, you're probably okay taking a couple of passes just to make sure that you got the message. I don't know. What's this crayon person talking about again?
Not crayon.
I don't know. I think crayon's on the wrong stream. Go.
Oh, man.
I hope that's your editor.
I think it is. I think
maybe,
it is.
Maybe not anymore.
What about you, D? Which one would you say?
I think I kind of hit on this topic before a little bit, because to me, it's like the writing is the sequence of events, and I kind of explained about the journey before and trying to get some memorable moments where, you know, the plot is more of the support of the story and the supporting of those events to that buildup. I mean, I don't know. I think that's just the way to go about all of that for me.
Okay. See, Keithan, who was going to be with us tonight, but he's still driving home. That California traffic is no joke. He says, what do you guys think of this trend with modern comics of writers extending scenes that used to be handled in one or two pages? Bendis, for instance, will have a long conversation scenes that are just page fillers. It's comics, not film. So what do y'all think about that? Like the over-exaggeration with things that can be done in one or two pages.
I will say this, Mr. Bendis is a wordsmith, and he likes to write. I mean, he gets it. Some panels are, and just my opinion, a little wordy, but he gets his point across, and he lets you know where the character's motivations are, and he throws in a few zingers here and there. I personally, that's too many words. That's too many. And I'm a word person. That's a lot of words. He uses a lot of words. Mm-hmm. Just like, for instance, his Legion intro page, it's just the whole page is just full of words about the story. I'm like, you can probably cut that down to like a couple paragraphs and keep it moving. But I mean, the man is great. He got where he was by doing it. So
I don't really understand why it would be called a trend in modern comics, since comics are, well, of course it goes back. I think about like Watchmen and how wordy and how hard some of that is to get through. A lot of these books that we look through with rose-colored glasses, Dark Knight Returns.
Very wordy.
The Last Halloween. A lot of great books are by, and to say of modern comics, it's not one homogenized thing. Comics are more diverse now than they've ever been. So, I mean, I don't know. If you don't like it, go read something else, I guess. I love Bendis. He's been one of my favorites for years. And if it's too wordy, I guess I will read something else. I don't know.
How about you, D?
Bendis has been in the game for a while, so I couldn't criticize him. I mean, you know, there's guys that can get away with that, especially if they have something of importance, of value to put within that, within those panels. So typically, I mean, you would try to stay away with it, especially if you're new to it, I would say, but, because you don't want to drag things on and keep people, idle in one spot. I mean, you want to keep the story flowing and moving quickly, but again, when you're a guy like Bendis or, you know, one of the other top writers like Scott Snyder, I think is one of them right now, they can pull that off and they can make that valuable, I think, for the reader.
Yeah. Because I don't like it. Go ahead, Tony.
There's an effect because the artist is also having to keep that amazing word count in his back of his mind when he draws the panels to allow that wording to fit in those spaces. And the letterer has to work double time sometimes to fit it all on that page. So the letterers, they need a hand. I mean, they need a serious amount of applause because they do some amazing things. They
make Thank you.
Work like
Thank you.
They make work. Yeah, they don't get the respect they deserve. They do tremendous work.
And if you're deciding to make your own creator comic, don't skimp on the letterer. Don't think or if your artist who, you know, maybe a well-meaning artist says, oh, I can, you know, I've got the software, I can stick some bubbles on the page. Kindly say thanks, but let's get someone who can letter on there. Yep. And
I've learned that the hard way.
Agreed.
I've learned that the hard
way. Yeah. One of the recent books that I started lettering for another company, they let the artist do it, and the artist did okay. But I was, you know, I asked them to let me do it and let me edit it at the same time, because that's how I learned how to letter. I looked at the letterers who were in the mainstream and saw what they did, and just did a bunch of studying, you know, which a lot of people don't do when they make comics now, which is weird. I did a lot of studying into lettering, and got better at it using my books. And I like to letter my own books because then I can go back and I'm like, okay, this is too mouthy, or this character wouldn't say that, or I can change things as, you know, as is going. But this is the first book that I've lettered that wasn't mine. And yeah, we have to do a lot of stuff. And luckily I'm editor of that book too. So like, if I see something, I'm like, I'm going to cut this down, but I go back to him like, hey, I'm cutting this down. Is this okay if I, you know, cut it down and make it fit into here a little more, so it's not covering the character's face because the panel is a little too small, you know? So yeah, there's a lot of magic that the letterers have to do to make things work. So
also about the being too wordy. I mean, if you prep properly, I don't, it's less likely you'll be caught in a situation like that. Sometimes what happens is they don't have the proper outline, the summaries and, you know, going through things to build that up properly. And the writer gets stuck just being overly wordly. So,
yeah,
you know, they're trying to squeeze things in that they didn't think of before because of preparation, lack of it.
Yeah. And that was, like I was saying, that's the main reason why, because I knew I was wordy with a lot of stuff when I'm writing the script off. Sometimes when I'm doing dialogue, I get into it. And then later I'm like, oh, okay, that's too much. Cena, again, says,
your artist, your editor just hit on what we just talked about.
Yep. She said, can we discuss leaving room for your lettering by the artist drawing?
Canale, why do you want the letterer to leave the room?
I think it was the masturbation thing
I was talking about earlier.
Jay, you're going to mess around and need a new editor, bro.
I think what they're saying is like,
I don't draw
for the artist.
I don't draw, but you know, that is something that happens with artists. That was something, I'm not going to say the name, but a comic that I wrote that was a note from the letterer that there wasn't a lot of room being left. Well, of course I'll need a new letterer, Kana. You just said they have to leave the room.
Oh, man. Okay. And then they also say, hey, man, letters having to deal with characters in the wrong placements. Yeah. Happens a lot. Oh, so Keith came back. Keith was saying he means page efficiency. If you literally don't progress the story, it feels like you didn't get your money's worth. Being wordy is fine if it works. And I agree with that, because like I've been wordy, for instance, in Temple High, which I think is probably one of the books where I've had the most words, you know, and that was mainly because it was going through a part where the students, you know how we do in school, the students kind of introduce themselves and say where they're from and all that. So it had that part. So I had a lot of words, but I did it in a way in the dialogue to where it moved along. So, and that's where I started learning how to play with dialogue as far as adding accents and, you know, doing things like taking off the, you know, because some people might not start, you know, with certain words in their sentences, or they might say duh instead of the and things like that. So I think if it keeps the story going, which I've noticed Bendis has, that's one of the good things that he does in some of his books. He keeps the story going. Yeah, that works. But like if it's just there and then you like look at it and you're like, oh man, should I keep going? Then yeah, I can understand that. Another question for you all. Dialogue in writing and in plotting. When you do your plot, do you think about your dialogue then, or do you wait till you start actually writing your story to think? I mean, I know we have to always think about the dialogue because that in a comic is what drives it. But I do know some people who just, whenever they do the plot, they just sketch it, you know, just write out the beats. You know, this is what I want on page one. This is what I want on page two. This is what I want on page three. I've seen scripts that were like that, and no dialogue or very minimum dialogue. So how do you go about it? Are you big in your dialogue during your plotting, or do you wait until you start writing to really start focusing on the dialogue?
I am not big in dialogue during plotting. Mm-hmm. If I jot down something or other, maybe, but that's about it. I like for the dialogue to be, that's something that happens in the line work. That's something that comes out in the scripting stage. If you're getting caught up in all your dialogue during your outlining, are you really even outlining anymore? And then when it comes to dialogue, the question is, how do I say as much as possible in few words as possible? Something I don't always succeed at. And how would this character talk? What's their voice? I was actually just talking with Kenyle Alexander, blah, blah, and we were talking about Star Trek Generations, where Leonard Nimoy refused to be in the film in the opening scenes because he said that the character they had put in name Spock was just a placeholder with generic lines that could have been spoken by anyone. Mm-hmm. What he was saying was they didn't give Spock a voice in the narrative. So when he declined the role, they just gave his lines to Scotty, which Nimoy then said exactly proved his point. So with dialogue, are you keeping it brief? Does your character have voice? Mm-hmm. There's a rule called I heard it at one writing workshop. It was Winnie the Pooh and Sex in the City. Think about both of the main characters for those casts. Every line they say can only be said by that character. Mm-hmm. If you hear it's a bad day, there's nothing to be happy about. Well, you can be blind and know who in Winnie the Pooh that is.
Yeah.
Or if you hear, oh, honey, give me my honey now. Give me some honey. You know, I'm stuck in this tree and whatever else. So do your characters have voice? Why is one any different from the other? What makes that character stand out? What motivates them? Why do they make the decisions that they make? Mm-hmm. Are they motivated by emotion? You know, like Belle in Beauty and the Beast, who finds out her father is missing and immediately jumps on the horse and goes into the woods to find him. mm-hmm. not stopping to think, hey, I could go back to the village and ask that, Woodsman guy who's always stalking me to help. Are they reacting to things? Or do you mm-hmm. have a reactionary character who things kind of happen to them? That happens too. Luke Skywalker in A New Hope. Shit's just happening to him the whole movie.
Very true.
The only decision that guy made was to go to Tashi Station and pick up some power converters. And he didn't even get to do that.
way late.
Didn't even make it.
The universe.
and then some characters are motivated by planning. They're manipulators. They think about what they're going to do. A shameless plug again, 3/31/21, you're going to meet H.H. Holmes in my graphic novel. He is a master planner. He had a plan for everyone he ever met. And much like some other villains, he got a little too cocky, and it was actually in history. It was the IRS that kind of took him down. So once you answer these questions, which are in the plotting stage, then you are ready to start putting words in their mouth.
Yep. Agreed.
Man, like Jay had said, plotting, I really don't do it too often, but mm-hmm. in the following footsteps on this one, shameless plug, Southside, The Side Pocket number 2, coming on Kickstarter. February 3rd. When I was plotting that issue, I had a scene of a bar fight. And mm-hmm. in that bar fight, I kind of threw some dialogue in it that Malone had said. And that at that one point, I kind of did put his dialogue in a plotting stage. But normally, like Jay, when I start the issue, I will script it then, and I go through and write everyone's dialogue, monologues, and such. Mm-hmm. Because it takes too much time for me. I'm used to doing it a certain way, so I'll plot everything out, then I'll go back and script it. So that's just how I do it.
Makes sense. Well, we're well past the hour, so I'm going to throw up one more question here, and then I'm going to let you all close it out with, letting folks know where to find you and everything and what you have coming up. So the next question is from Dan Smith. Dan, what's going on? Okay, mechanically, how do you plot? Just in your heads, flow chart, timeline? How do you stay organized? For me, I have we all remember that what was it, the story web we all probably did in school when they first started teaching you how to write stories. And this is horrible. I still do that. It's a little more advanced now, but I still do that. Like I have my points, the beginning, middle, end, and then I write the things that I want to happen in the beginning. That leads to the middle, and then the middle that leads to the end, and then put the climax in there, and then express what I want to happen during that climax that leads into the next story. That's me doing it issue to issue, but I do the same thing for the entire story arc. So what about y'all? How do you go about it, Tony?
In my head, I have the entire Advent universe across all the titles, but I have a series of notebooks. My wife teases me all the time. She's like, you have stacks and stacks of notebooks. Why? And I'm like, mm-hmm. Those are stories, the character Bibles. That's pretty much the entire thing. I write something down after it comes to my head. And then I learned this trick from an editor friend of mine. I'll do like a, I forgot what the actual title of this board is, but basically I'll put everything on a board that I have, a whiteboard that I have in my den area. And I'll just plot everything out off that whiteboard, make sure everything matches up, beats, and everything that I want to have happen. And you'd be surprised how efficient that is. But that's how I do it. I have all three. I have tons of notebooks going back to when I was in middle school. So mm-hmm. you name it, it's there. It's there.
Yeah, I got to get things out of my mind because they're in there and I feel weird.
Oh, yeah. I'm an old man now. I don't get it out and write it down in some fashion, whether it's on my tablet or in my phone. It'll be gone within 10 minutes, I guarantee it.
Hey, you there. Anyone else want to jump on that question? Or?
No? I mean, for me, I do everything in my head and then work my way over, like notes, And then from like just minor little notes, then I build up like a one or two pages on that and then go from there. Okay. And then I would work with a timeline.
Okay.
Makes sense. The iPod, I saw James editor write something on the screen. It just caught me by surprise.
Jay is found in the road under the car. That will be teaching him a new plot, grave plots. Well, you know what? You know what, Kanaza? I hope that car is a Honda Civic.
Oh, man.
All right, I'll answer the question, and then I guess I better go take out a restraining order.
You might have two on this.
A lot of people have their own preferences. I say do what works for you. My best friend, editor, and great letterer, and she's also a co-creator on an upcoming comic you'll be hearing more about later, Senna AL. She loves to script through Scrivener and Final Draft for comics. Mm-hmm. I love Google Docs because I have it on all of my devices. I can create a file for each work that I'm doing. I've gotten now to where I have to create folders for different companies that I work with. I got my black box folder, I've got my Mad Cave folder, I've got my Zenoscope folder, and I've got my Erie River folder. And I'm just going to throw something out there since we're talking about cliffhangers. Here's a cliffhanger for you. I added two new folders this week for new publishers. What were they? I'm not going to tell you. You'll just have to tune in and hopefully get on my website, jsandlin.com, my newsletter. Follow me on Twitter, Instagram, and Facebook. Get ready for H.H. Holmes on 3/31/21. And not long after that, get ready for Jen Hunter from Black Box Comics. What were we looking at again for Jen Hunter, D?
For the first issue, I think it's going to be July, I believe.
There we go.
Oh, nice. Nice.
There we go. It's going
to be that.
It's going to be a summer scorcher when the realms are in chaos and one djinn hunter is going to have to hunt down a rogue djinn by going back to the one person she hoped she'd never have to face again. Her ex-girlfriend.
Uh-oh. I see the drama already. I'm gonna check that out.
I'm gonna send you a copy, and I'm gonna make sure you check it out.
Awesome, thank you. I appreciate it, and we'll get a review too.
No worries, it's just gonna be a digital. I'm not splurging.
Oh, no worry, no worries. I do the same thing. I'm like, here's the digital.
Well, you send me your stuff too.
Oh yeah, definitely, most definitely. D, you next. Well, you know, just let everybody know where they can find you. What do you have coming out?
Blackboxcomics.net is our website. BlackboxComicsP on Twitter and BlackboxComics on Facebook or Instagram. Easy to find us. So we'll probably be the first one that comes up on that list.
Awesome. And Tony.
AdventComics.com is our website. You can find us also on Facebook, Instagram, and Twitter under Advent Comics. We have several titles coming up in the first quarter. I think we have Southside 2, which is going on Kickstarter on the 3rd, February 3rd. We have The Regulators 2, which is in production, almost done. You're probably going to get that in a few weeks. We're getting it lettered now, so that should be ready shortly. Cosmos 6 is coming. Titan Ultraman 3 is almost done with colors, beginning on letters, so you'll see that soon. We have Black Star Line number 5 coming out. We're also going to have a couple new titles that I'm introducing. Old Glory number 1, that's going to be coming the first quarter, and I might add two more titles to the roster. I'm not certain yet because I am a continuity person and these two titles fall into a certain point. Mm-hmm. So if I can get one book that I'm working on finished those two new titles will be added. But right now, that's nice. What we can set.
Nice. I understand that.
Same. I wanted to give a quick shout out. I have one more book coming out called Shinokai. Okay. I'm actually wearing the shirt.
Nice.
So I don't know if you guys can see it, but
yeah, I can.
Yeah, it's our first published book from another creator-owned team because all of the other titles are ours.
Okay. Very awesome. Congrats on that.
Are you gonna release that book coming up soon, or
Shinokai comes out? I believe it's January 27th, next Wednesday.
Oh, that's perfect.
Okay.
You're gonna look out for that, D. Pick that up.
Thanks, man. Appreciate it, Tom.
Definitely. All right, everybody. That concludes our show. And you know where you can find us, IndieComics Dispatch. You can find us at IndieComicsDispatch.com. We also have a Patreon. There's our Patreon down at the bottom. We have this thing going right now based off of one of our shows where one of our members of the IndieComics Dispatch family asked a very vital question that pretty much stopped the show when they asked, what is D&D? So if we can get to 10 patrons, we're actually going to do a show where we're playing D&D and introduce them to D&D. You can also find us on Instagram, Twitter, Facebook, at IndieComics Dispatch. And for me personally, for Sovereign Comics, you can find me on Facebook at Sovereign Comics. You can find me on Instagram, www.sovereigncomics.com. I'm also on Twitter. Just look for the orange lion head, and that's me. So, all right.
Thank you for having me. Thank you for allowing me to be with these two fine individuals. I appreciate it. Like I said,
you're all great. Thank you.
I'm fans of all three. So I'll be looking forward to picking up your stuff.
Same here, man.
Thanks everybody for joining. Thank you everybody out there who asked questions. Greatly appreciate it. It's a good show. Appreciate it. Have a good one, everybody.
Take care.
Good night.